please have Danielle, Steve, and Ari come up.
I'm the Senior Vice President of Marketing and Business Development at GST Auto Leather, and we are in a rebirth phase, just like leather is for our industry today, so it's a wonderful time to be here again. I did spend the first 25 years of my career on the other side of the tracks with the Automotive Leather and Carpet Group, so I've been in the automotive interior business for a long time, and frankly that's part of the theme of what I'll be covering today. But regarding the consumer situation, we in the automotive industry, and I'll speak to that, and again, this theme has been prevalent throughout the day. For us, we are at a crossroads right now, and it's something that we believe there's a significant amount of confusion out there today with our customers as to the product that they're getting in their vehicle. The synthetic industry has done a wonderful job to develop a product now that duplicates our natural leather product very, very well. And in terms of how it is described and how it is presented to the consumer today in dealerships and in the advertisements, it's a very, very gray area. And frankly, that's one of the things we're going to continue to promote, primarily with the consumers, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, but also even with our OEM executives, that our belief is consumers, they deserve to know the description of the material. It's a very, very big purchase they're making when you talk about a vehicle, and they really do deserve to have that ability to understand what's inside the vehicle. So again, I'll talk more about it in a little bit, but it's we in our industry are at a crossroads.
Excellent, thank you. Danielle, you want to say a question? Will you please introduce yourself, tell us about yourself, and then tell us how you see leather connect with consumer values today.
I'm Daniele Gabini from Porto Marcao.
Sorry for my English. I work in Porto Marcao since 2001, and I'm the responsible of research and development at Porto Marcao. Is not only home furniture, but also contract division. Contract is everything is for public area. And the other department is interior emotion. Interior emotion is what everyone is movement, car, both plane, etc. For Porto Marcao, leather is a big value because is our queen.
I heard the seats that we're sitting
yes.
in are from Porto Marcao.
The seats
very comfortable.
These,
can I have some delivered to my home?
Oh, yes.
I like these.
My preference is this Archibald chair.
I'll have to try that one out later.
Yes, just in this year is 10 years old and is our new icon. First of these, the icon of Porto Marcao is the Vanity Fair, the Mickey Mouse chair.
Oh, wow, Disney.
And now, the new icon, because the volume of selling is best now, is this chair. Leather, like I say, is a big value for Porto Marcao. So, this is why more or less 15 years ago, Porto Marcao decided to create this office. First of these, this office don't exist. Each people that work in Burkina Faso know about leather. Our president in that moment want to achieve and give to the opportunities of this office to receive food all the legacy in leather that Burkina Faso has in that moment. So, like I say, is a big value because we create this office and work each day, me and my team, in research, but especially in development, because the very difficult is to bring the leather that is, I think, the most variability material that I know, bring this material in production to have objectivity of the work.
That's excellent. Thank you so much.
So I'm Ari, I'm a Risa Parsons grad, and I'm in the process of starting my own brand, Ari 500. In terms of leather from an entrepreneurial perspective, I feel like leather is a material that has a different respect across the board from everybody across the world, internationally. There's a certain quality that leather brings to the table that no other material has been able to match, and people recognize that across all generations. I don't think that there is an adequate match to leather in terms of, you know, we can talk about vegan leather, we can talk about Phenotex. Nothing is comparable to authentic, really cow hide. So that's what I choose to work with.
And you know, before you mentioned that leather is very versatile, and you just mentioned some of your preference, but why do you have a particular preference for one leather over another?
So in my collection, I decided to use veg tan, and I really wanted to use a leather that, when you saw it, you could automatically recognize the quality that was there. And I also really enjoy the structure that comes with using veg tan. I use, I'm sure everyone knows, but 5 ounce veg tan. So there's no need for stabilizers in it. It holds its own shape and weight independently. And I really just like the simplicity that comes with it. There's a certain feel and give that veg tan has that I personally don't feel chromium.
Absolutely. Thank you. And now I hear you have a presentation for us, is that right? And then can you answer one question for me before you go up? So we talked a little bit about all types of different leathers, but you and I also talked about what's happening with the, in terms of vegan and alternative materials. So what do you see happening with those, and how should the leather industry respond and communicate to the consumer?
This is an important point, because in the last time our company must have information regarding leather, asking from mass media, etc. So what I can say is that for leather for us is really important. So not since now, but since different years, we work principally with Italian tannery that respect law and regulation, not only European but also international. And in the last 2-3 years, we work at a project that now for us is a reality, that is looking for sustainability. It's clearly that leather come from an animal, but is a recycled material. What is our opinion? We must find the best solution for reduce the CO2 emission. So in this, with this project, We work with a tannery that is not like a supplier, but for us is like a partner to reduce step by step in the production, start with the raw material that in this case is fresh, since the end transportation, minimize the CO2 reduction. And for us now, this is a reality. But at the same time, we are looking for, like in this morning, when speakers speak about new material, for example, bio leather. We are stuck now. The time is very long, I think. But we are investigating because we want to give to our customer a solution and an answer regarding what Ottona Frau do about sustainability.
That's a really good point. It's very important to educate our consumers on what we're doing in our practices and our processes. Do you want to share your presentation with us? Thank you.
Intelligence on our hands is an apology that we created because we believe that craftsmanship is our storytelling.
The greatest stories are stories about love, and Poltrona Frau's story is one of these. Over 100 years of emotions which have seduced millions of people. The spark was struck in Turin. Lorenzo Frau, a resourceful upholsterer,
realized that his taste
was emerging deep within buildings and homes. That is how Poltrona Frau came to life. Its original armchairs in prized leather immediately captivated the public, charmed by the fitting interplay between modernity, brand, and communication. Poltrona Frau creates voluptuous icons, imitated by many, desired by all. The upper classes and Italian nobility choose them as a mark of prestige. Lorenzo dies soon after, and it is his wife who carries his dream forth. His vision remains and inspires Savina in the creation of ageless masterpieces, leading Poltrona Frau above and beyond. With the war, everything grinds to a halt. The economic boom brings a running start, and this time, unstoppable momentum. The company has purchased and moved to the Marche region, enhancing the values of its origins. It is the period of Franco Moschini's leadership, new collaborations, and timeless success. The world pursues change, and Poltrona Frau opens itself up to a revolution, embracing a modern design yet imbued with its own history. The renewal culminates with the birth of the interiors in motion and contract divisions. Now, Poltrona Frau's style also dresses offices and meeting places, and the world of travel. fateful encounter leads into the new millennium, and the company becomes a group, acquiring industry-leading brands. Fresh from the victory of the Design Wallpaper Award, the brand celebrates its centenary, and it does so with great style. Michele De Lucchi designs the Poltronafrau Museum, where history looks to the future. 2 years later, the first showroom in China opens, a prelude for milestones in Asia and in the world, such as the El Decor International Design Award. Today, Poltronafrau flies high, made strong by its long-lasting values and part of a new international family. Its products confer prestige to the most sophisticated interiors in the world, to naval craft, and even to aeroplanes. A story of love, quality, and beauty, born from a brilliant mind. It still thrives in the hearts of those who it has charmed through the years.
Since 5 years ago, Ferrari produced more or less 7,000
and 700 cars per year. Now are more or less 9,000, and in the plane of the Ferrari for the next 2-3 years, they want to arrive to 12,000 cars per year. We also created a museum in Burkina Faso in 2012. And start with a short video to show you our museum that is created studied by Michele De Lucchi. Another important point for us, we can say, is a craftsmanship. All our product is made by hand. And leadership is a neologism that we created because we believe that it's really important for us, leather, and we believe that the leather is for us not only past and present, also future. My office, like I say, work each day for find, innovation, research, new possibility, but also work for obtain a homogeneity in production on the level. And quality, like you don't understand, is really important.
Thank you.
We have in our catalog three typology of letters, from aniline, semi-aniline, and pigment and finished leather. It's clearly that is most important for us when our cell leather have in front the final client to explain the difference of the leather. Aniline is beautiful but sensible. Semi-aniline is for me just perfect compromise. And finish a pigment if you don't have don't want problem with this. We have 11 collection and in total 181 columns. So it's possible make really like a customization. Color system is our bestseller leather because I think that more or less 60-70% of our product is in color system. The leather that is on this chair, that name is Haida. Heritage is a leather that I love. It is a pull-up leather that come from a raw material based in North America. We use for a whole other article European raw material. For this article we use North America. Two cases we have in our article that leather come from North America. One is of this and the other one is for Ferrari leather. Ferrari leather is the raw material that comes from North America. Mesh leather is our semi-hunting leather that is on Archibald and San Luca. It's a semi-hunting leather. The sole leather is our semi-hunting that represents more or less 10% of our product. Century is a leather that is born in 2012 for our centenary. It's like a stonewash leather. Cavallino is just a name, it's not a horse, but is a cow, like you imagine. Saddle is a Tuscany saddle. Just a point, we use principally leather that come from Italy, yes, but in the Vicenza area, Alzignano. In this case, we use a leather that come from Santa Croce, because it's a vegetable tan. Video. This chair we present last year just to give possibility to customization for our customer. The back of the seats is in saddle and we painted by hand the back. And what we want communicated is a craft machine for leather kits.
Thank you so much.
We'd like to
also pass
the
microphone to
Sarah
Lee, who is Hi, Steve. How are you?
How are you?
Very well. I'm so excited to talk about the leather and automotive industry and their connections, especially since there's so many exciting things happening there. I know you have a presentation for us too, but I do have a question for you. So we've seen the use of leather actually decline a bit in the U.S. and the Chinese automotive sector. Can you tell us why and what's changed?
it really gets back to the description and to the layout. It's really the issue. There's no question there's a cost difference, and that certainly does play into it by some of the OEM decisions, frankly. And what they're putting together now with vehicles, with the technology, with the safety measures, with the gadgets, et cetera, they've got to pack a lot of information, a lot of products into these vehicles. And certainly when they look at cost-saving opportunities, the synthetic product versus the leather is certainly going to be less expensive. And that's fine. But again, it gets back to the labeling and the true description of the consumer to make sure they understand, because they have an option. They do have an option to either select the synthetic or select the leather interior if they know what it is. So it does come back to the same thing we talked about earlier. And frankly, that's all we continue to ask for. And that'll be my very last slide. And the word has come up in many of the talks already tonight, and that's transparency. There needs to be clear transparency on that, because leather is a wonderful product. And again, I'll talk about it here in a second, but we have conducted many, many different consumer research studies over the last 10 years, and unanimously the feedback from the consumer is they prefer leather. It's unbelievable the ratio of that particular data, and we've certainly shared that with our customer. They get it, but at the end of the day, they're trying to run a business, and that's why now the initiatives are ongoing. Right now with Leather Naturally, with One for Leather, with the LIA effort, we've really got to get to the consumer and get the message out there and basically allow them 10 seconds to make the decision. If they decide it's synthetic, fine. But from what we've seen, the preference is leather.
I think you hit a lot of good buzzwords: transparency, consumer, and education. And I know you have a presentation for us.
Mine?
Yeah? All you? You want to take a mic?
Let me get mine. There we go. Let me get my props up here. First, while I'm doing that, is Frank still here? Did he leave? I was going to offer him a consulting job here to go to Europe with me next week to see all of our European names. So I've got to get his number of him when he's got here. So, he hit such a home run exactly what we're up against. Secondly, I want to let everybody know that 2 years ago I spoke at this Congress in Shanghai, and my presentation slot was right after lunch, and I had to deal with all of the headlines. So, in this case now, John rewarded me by putting me right at the end, so I understand this, okay? Alright, so first of all, what I'd like to do is I'm going to cover just a few macro industry highlights for you, and then we're going to drill down and pivot to more of the surface material. So this graph is a graph of the global automotive bill that is projected from 2014 to 2025. And folks, this is an extraordinary volume story. And even though that basically here this year, China is down, which frankly is the first time in the last 15 years after a phenomenal growth streak they've had, there is softening in North America, there is softening in Europe, but still the projection over the next few years, as you can see, is a steady growth up to roughly 105 million vehicles by 2025. And really, you know, this industry, it fuels thousands of companies and millions of jobs around the world, and the infrastructure is significant. So for us, even though it's a very, very demanding market for us, a very demanding set of customers, we only have 15 or so around the world, it's worth it. Because for us to be part of this industry, this volume justifies it. So the next page, going a little bit further, and again, it's not any surprise that the two regions that are driving that growth are China and Southeast Asia. We've talked about it a lot for other industries. Super important for us in automotive. And that's where a tremendous amount of focus, I mean, quite frankly, that's where a lot of the issues are right now in terms of the labeling, et cetera, are in China. But also, an interesting note here is if you take a look at the small bullet there, by 2035, China is saying that they are going to demand, target, 40% of the vehicles that are built will be electric. And typically when China says they're going to do something, they're going to do it. So if you look down at the second point, the new energy vehicle These are five companies here that, frankly, I've hardly heard of, and I'm sure most of you have not heard of, but these are new companies that right now that are leading the way in the electric vehicle development. So whether they're going to be here in 2035, this is our projection along with some industry analysts of who the top five local companies look like they will be moving forward. So as we meet 10 years from now, we may have guest speakers from these companies as well. But it is certainly in China. It's going to be a reality in China, we believe, before anywhere else in the world in terms of large volume. The next bullet point, again, no surprise, these are the five leading global OEM companies around the world. This has typically been the ranking for several years now. But for us in our business, obviously the luxury OEMs are very important too. So even though you don't see a BMW, Daimler, a JLR, Volvo up on this page, it's super important for us because of the amount of leather that they're using. The next three bullet points are statistics that I think are significant here for us to talk about. First of all, the luxury market. So I talk about 100 plus million vehicles a year. Basically, the luxury vehicle production will be 10% of that. And for us in the leather industry, we have got to dominate that sector. Now, we're going to obviously continue to look to expand other segments, but this segment we've got to dominate, and this is the one where there have been some concerns here in terms of that real estate. So again, it's a strong projection for us in the luxury end of this business going forward, especially as we cross that 100 million barrier. The next statistic I want to share with you is the amount of surface material real estate. I'm going to use that term a couple times here in the next few minutes. Basically, in 2020, we're projecting plus or minus 5 to 10% that 5.5 billion net square feet of material is going to be used, this is primarily for seating on the global vehicle build around the world. What that is made up of is obviously our leather, synthetics, fabric, and suede. And in the past, we have typically competed against our leather competitors. That's been the battle because really our share has remained constant. But what's happening now, we have to look at this real estate. We have now got to look at this 5.5 billion and the amount of synthetic that is taking over, we've got to get that position back. And that's, again, getting back to us doing an industry job to try to get the message out to the consumer because they're the people when we go to the dealership that can make a difference for us and steal back some of that real estate. The next bullet, again, a stat that is frankly pretty staggering, that since 2014, we're projecting out here to 2019, the automotive leather market has gone down 30% from a revenue standpoint. Roughly $4.5 billion in 2014, we're projecting it to be, again, plus or minus 5 to 10%, at a $3.2 billion level this year. Now, a couple of things are occurring. Number one, the pricing has gone down significantly because a lot of our prices are based on high cost index, and we all know what's happened to high cost. Secondly, it's the decontenting. It's putting more of the synthetic into the vehicle, either part of the leather seat or actually the entire seat, the entire vehicle being synthetic. And I'm talking about Mercedes E-classes. I'm talking about BMW 5 Series. It's really crazy how much it's really starting to permeate throughout the industry. And then the other point is that, again, the major reductions, the major decontenting are occurring here in the U.S. and China. Europe is pretty pure, but in Europe, as most of you know, typically they will go in and buy a car, they'll sit down at a dealership, and they will actually spec out what they want. A la carte, it'll take 8 weeks to deliver, but they get what they want. In the U.S. and China, people go into a dealership, there's 200 vehicles, and they get what's on that lot, and the salespeople are trying to sell what's on the lot, and they want to move. So it's a little different dynamic, and again, that's part of the world. And then finally, the industry initiatives. And we're so happy, as I mentioned earlier, Leather Naturally is going to kick off their campaign in probably August. One for Leather, which is a group of leather suppliers in Europe, are going to kick off the One for Leather campaign probably July, August as well. A little bit different message, but a very similar theme to consumers, et cetera. And then, of course, John's effort with the LIA sent in an extraordinary study and proposal to the FTC. So we're doing the right thing, and hopefully this momentum is going to take place. All right, so now we want to pivot to the surface material slide here. So the first thing we're going to talk about is the synthetic coated fabric, PVC and PU. And this is the material that is slowly creeping into our neighborhood, into our real estate. And frankly, I think I speak for our industry. We respect these synthetic products, but for what they are, they've got a place, no question. You want an easy to clean product, that's fine. But it is not level. And it is not right for labeling not to be clear and for it to be mistaken to be level. And that's what our theme is going to continue to be, is that, as I said earlier, the consumer deserves to understand the description of the product that's inside the field. So again, it's an issue. Now, in terms of taking a look at the chemistry steps, there's way too many syllables in here for me to go through that with you. You can see it. But basically, in a nutshell, what we're talking about here with these synthetic products is basically we've got plastic. We've got man-made material. We've got products that basically are very, very industrial, petroleum-based, whether it's PVC, PU, and in essence, the way it's produced, the chemistry is rolled onto a skin carrier through a series of rolls. It is basically compacted, and then it is transferred to a fabric substrate, which again, by the way, is man-made, petro-based, and then it's rolled up in Boston and it's shipped out. So again, it's not a very interesting process, very industrial, very continuous, but again, it is what it is. Now the next product is fabric. So again, the fabric, getting back to the real estate, getting back to the neighborhood, fabric has its niche, and it clearly is not competing with leather. And it's always, consumer understands fabric, they know what they're getting, but again, we're dealing with a product here that frankly has got tremendous options of color, endless, infinite options of color, pattern, very intricate technologies, knitting and weaving to produce the products. But again, plastic, primarily polyester in the case of automotive fabrics, plastic, petroleum-based, man-made, and once you tie in the ends of yarn and fibers to make the product, you turn on the switch, and it's continuous. It rolls, you send out rolls, and again, it's not a very unique, it's not a very expressive operation in terms of being handcrafted. But again, it's got its place in the industry. And then finally, we've got our product. This is the enhanced natural material. For those of you that are not leatherheads in the audience, I know we have a lot here, take a look at the number of steps these go through. The number of times that hands touch these products from one step to another. This is hand craftsmanship. Every single hide has got a unique story. And that's what we try to convey to our customers is understand the beauty of this product, the story, and basically, you can see there's nothing like that. So for us, it's we play in this automotive industry, we play in a zero defect world. Everything else on that vehicle has got to be perfect, to spec, to detail, to dimensions, et cetera, et cetera. What we try to promote is that our product is the perfect imperfect material. And that to us is what is attractive to leather, and that's what we continue to try to separate ourselves from the pack regarding the surface material network. So then the next couple of slides what I want to share with you is I have to share these, and there's two or three slides regarding the recent nasty propaganda from the NGOs that are really being conveyed to a lot of our customers, a lot of the executives, and this is, the first one being that it's coming out to many of the executives we deal with around the world is the fact that we kill the animals for the hides, which we all know is crazy, and basically, this is where we've been going back to the customer and say, listen, it's where it all began. I mean, mankind has been needing to get protein to survive for centuries. And they were ingenious enough back then to take, just like you talked about, we take the hides and they use them for warmth, for shelter, and also for clothing over the years. And I guarantee you, if you look closely enough, in Freddie Flintstone's buggy, they probably had leather seatbelts. But again, it's not a new breakthrough. What we're dealing with, this has been going on for centuries, and that's a message that again, we've got to continue to convey to the industry. And secondly, again, we've seen this already today, these are the statistics, and protein is required for nutrition is required for life, and these are the projections out in 2019 and 20 in terms of the cattle population and also of beef consumption. So if, in fact, this is going to remain, demand is going to remain somewhat steady, then our industry is going to continue to thrive. But we've got to preserve the volume. And again, it gets back to the messaging to our customer of why leather is different than the next criticizing point that we're getting from these from the NGOs is the fact that the facilities have got issues with environmental malpractice, with sustainability, with animal welfare, and traceability. So this is going to be the cornerstone, quite frankly, of the One for Leather campaign that's going to be kicked off in July or August. It's going to be a big part of it, the initial phase. And this is a page here that frankly, one of our top suppliers, one of the leading animal protein producers in the world, shared with me from their company profile. And again, there is a tremendous amount of sophistication out there right now in our industry that needs to be shared with our customers. They need to see what we have done as an industry. No longer are these four shows out there of facilities and welfare and labor, et cetera. We have very, very sophisticated standards now within the industry to protect ourselves, and this is what the One for Leather campaign is going to make sure that they focus on. This is as an example. We think that companies in this industry now have got it, and it's a big part of how we operate. So really, in conclusion, at least for this part of my talk, and then I'm going to go to some eye candy, is basically our message each and every day when we see our customers around the world, designers, engineers, commercial, etc., is that leather is a luxury symbol. And because I talked about the consumer research studies we've done, people aspire and prefer the genuine leather products. And we have to continue to press them. It's an important part of our existence, and it is such a different product than the alternatives in our neck of the woods that leather is going to have to sustain. So those four words that you see on the top of the page here, I think everyone in here, and anybody out on 18th Street, when they think about these four words, it's a warm feeling, and that's the emotional connection of leather. There just is something about leather that's different, and we think, again, this is a story here that needs to be continually told. All right, and what we do continually as a company is we research different auto shows, different trade shows, for our internal inspiration from a design standpoint, but also our design customers around the world do ask us to bring in what trends we're seeing out there, predominantly in different design shows, et cetera. So what I'm going to share with you is that our team has been out here in the last few months, and I've got pictures from the Milan Furniture Fair, as well as the Geneva Auto Show. So first of all, the Milan Furniture Fair. So on the left there, you can see a basket that typically might have been a wood product, now 100% leather, very, very unique. And the right-hand side is the Louis Vuitton chair that if this autonomous vehicle thing really hits 2030, 2040, this may be what a seat looks like in the back seat. Who knows? But a very unique seat. Next is the Pininfarina Battista. The uniqueness on this one is take a look at the colors on the seat. So this is something that we think is intriguing and probably can take hold. Typically, all the vehicles have got a common color in all of the different seating areas. You can see the navy and the tan seats, and of course also the updated quilting effect, which has gotten a tremendous amount of popularity lately in the automotive world. So really a couple of points on this one. Next, in the Bentley section, again, the quilting effect, which is getting very, very popular, with the piping, the navy piping, the contrast. And on the far right side, there was a lot of green in the show, and also high gloss on the leather. So this is what we put in here to demonstrate. kind of information we'll share with the OEM customers so they can see what's happening out in furniture shows, in apparel shows, because they'll take that and they'll go to work, and some of these actually do come back into the automotive market at some point in time. Next is the Lamborghini. It's a very unique seat set here. As you can see, it's a combination of leather and Alcantara. The white is the leather, the black is the Alcantara suede. Also on the dashboard picture, that is Alcantara in the top pad and leather on the bottom. So again, a nice combination of the concept car. Next is the Bugatti, fantastic color. If you take a look at the tires, that's a really neat effect they put there. But the other key point here is typically embroidery in the past has been used to actually describe certain images of names, Jeep, Wrangler, you name it, etc. In this case, it's actually a design effect. So this is an embroidery effect, which is a little bit different than what's been used in the past. And then the second point here is take a look on the left-hand side of the picture. Again, this is a blue door panel and a charcoal door panel. So again, a contrasting or combination of color on door panels, which is different than we've seen. Next is the Lagonda, the Aston Martin Lagonda. What's unique here, we've got four different natural products. It's a woven leather carpet, and then it's a combination of the seating and door areas of silk, cashmere, and alpaca. So again, it was wonderful to see this, considering all of the synthetic products we talked about earlier, the fact that we've got this vehicle that's done a concept car, all natural products. Next is the Maserati, and here they partnered up with Xenia and Giorgetti for woven leather interior components, wood effects, as well as silk fabric, and inserted that product as well. So again, the natural effect, it's very refreshing to see that on a concept car coming out from Maserati as well. Lexus, a combination of quilting and random perforation. This particular design theme is pretty prevalent right now in today's market, but it continues to be what can we do with the surface effects to get more and more interest with these leather interiors, and we're having many different options, many different color options coming our way in the future as well. And again, something to distinguish ourselves amongst the other surface material options. Rolls-Royce, embroidered leather on the door panel. You can see a unique headliner. This is a leather headliner with LED lighting that they're promoting can be customized to the constellation pattern of your birthday. So, for your next Rolls-Royce, keep that in mind when you go to the dealership. That's what you can ask for. But it's, again, a tremendous effect, obviously, that only Rolls can do. And then finally, we've got the Rolls-Royce, the Mansory Billionaire Edition. Again, another embroidery effect here. Again, not as much necessarily in terms of actually scripting out a certain word, etc., but actually used for design effects. So, again, a tremendous effect here in the whole interior. A lot of light colors, you can see that as well. And again, that's why we have such a need for the anti-soil technology going forward. We've had tremendous breakthroughs from our partners. Thank you very much, those of you that are out there. So that was just, again, a little bit of an oversight of some of the shows we've been to here in 2019. But the last slide here that I want to share with you about early transparency. So again, I'm just going to stay on that theme. Frankly, two ways. One, we're getting a lot of demand from our customer to go backwards and try to understand the traceability of the animals. It's a very, very difficult task for us to get past and go all the way to the ranches, but we've got to work with that. And that's something that immediately with Volvo is a need that we have. And we're working on maybe a secluded number of cattle in the United States to be able to do that. That is a need, but then going forward, it is the transparency to just allow the customer to understand what's in the vehicle. And I promise you, those of you that are in the U.S. or China, now that you've heard this come out of my mouth the last 20 minutes, go to a dealership, ask them to explain what that product is, the material in the vehicle. And I'm going to tell you, unfortunately, probably more than 50% are going to give you the wrong answer. And that's the problem. And that's all we're suggesting, is educate and provide the real skills. That's it. Thank you.
Someone coming up to discuss the Parsons competition? Councilman Parsons. Otherwise, yeah, we can open the floor up for a couple of questions. Pass the mic to. There you go.
Thank you. My question is not just for this panel here, which I thought was terrific, but also on the previous panel. And Steve, I think fantastic presentation you made there. I'm with you there, though. You know, you're in the garage, and the guy says, this is leather. And you say, no, it's fake leather, or it's synthetic leather, or it's synthetic, it's PU. And they said, no, it's leather, I guarantee it. Just smell it, I'm just going to buy it. So, yes, huge learning curve has to be made by the industry. But I go back to people from Coach and from Tory Burch as well, in terms of neither mentioned that they had an issue in regards to whether things were leather or non-leather. Which is encouraging in a way, because does it mean to say that there is no competition? But it seems to me that all the cars you were talking about, sir, were mid to top end. Most of what Coach and Tory Burch is mid to top end. Does that mean to say there's a sort of price level where people start to ask, and it means that they're environmentally thinking about whether these issues are really important to them? Do people, when they go to the supermarket and they buy a carton of milk, do they want to know what cow it comes from? No. So the question I'm asking is really in terms of, is there a level where people are saying for Louis Vuitton, or for Rolls Royce, or for Tory Burch, it's leather, it's fantastic, I'm going to buy it because the brand is so strong. Anything beneath it is questionable, and therefore I'll ask, are the millennials who are in the audience here today worrying about, saying, utilizing athleisure materials and materials made out of petroleum products which are going to stay with us forever? A question.
Lots to unpack there. Multiple things to discover. So I'm going to pass the mic and let you start. Sure.
From the research studies we did, there is a level there where, and it gets back to the label, that there's many consumers that don't care. And for them, if they get synthetic or they get fabric based on the level and segment of the vehicle they're buying, they're fine with it, no question about it. But there are many, many, many people that prefer leather. And whether it's in the top end or drifting down to certain segments, they do like leather. They like the story. They like the fact that leather's been part of their life in many different ways, many different articles in their household for years, and they want the real leather. What's happened, I won't get too lengthy on this, but I'll tell you what happened in this. So back in the mid-90s, in the automotive world, 90% of the surface material was fabric. 10% was leather, only in the luxury end, and there was no synthetic because the products were inferior. Absolutely, virtually zero. So what happened is an explosion occurred back in the mid-90s, primarily in the U.S., and China wasn't even aboard at that time, but in the U.S., with the family vehicles and the SUVs, where then the families were looking for material that could be cleanable. Well, the only material that was cleanable was leather in the portfolio of the OEMs, so leather became that alternative product. So leather went from 10% to 30% like that, between 95 and 2000. Not in Europe. Europe has always remained a luxury product. 15 to 20%, it's had its place and it stayed that way. But in the US, it exploded. So what's happened now is people grew up in that age, the millennials and the Gen X's, who basically in their vehicle, it wasn't fabric, it was leather. And it was called leather, it was highlighted as leather. But in a lot of cases, it was because it was cleanable. So what's happened here in the last 5 to 8 years is that the synthetic products have gotten better. They do meet the requirements. In fact, a couple of young ladies during a break were talking about that. Well, do they meet the performance? Yes, they do. But they're not real. So they now have decided, the OEs, because it's such a cost disparity, and we'll never touch that, is they're going to put the synthetic in as the alternative because it still has that leather effect to it. It's still cleanable. And now people still think they're getting leather because it is not described adequately enough for most of them over the last 20 years, anything that wasn't fabric was welded. And that's what's happening.
Do you have, Mrs. Tubman, anything to add?
Just this question for us is very difficult to answer because in the automotive industry, we work for high-end quality. And keep in mind that customer for Ferrari on the best, the most luxury material that is possible to have. So is this no question for us? Because in that position, there are holy leather. The question is to respect the expectative of the customer, the customer of Ferrari. So we must work to obtain a really performance leather, but at the same time, a leather that has property, organoleptic property, that like touch and feeling. I can't respond, I can answer about general market in the automotive industry because we work only for this OEM and this part of the car.
Are you okay?
Yes.
Ari, do you want to respond from a design aesthetic standpoint?
Sure. So as far as fashion, Victoria Birch and Coach both offer bags that are made out of PVC as well as leather bags. But you can see the price reflection. I do feel like, however, millennials, and I'm a part of Gen Z, we are looking for quality products that aren't going to fall apart, and characteristically, PVC, vinyl, PU, at some point, they just don't last nearly as long as leather. You're not going to get a quality product that's going to last you 2-3 decades. And although you can clean PU, there's something a little bit more sentimental about something that's made out of leather. And I definitely think we're on the curve of trying to get into more authentic materials that are really lasting us a lot.
Thank you. Do we have any other announcements?